Hey everybody, this is Deb with Truthification Chronicles, and this is going to be a little different video because I'm not going to take the time to go through all of these things, but I wanted to share these links with you so that you could check them out for yourself and you'd have this information. Remember, I view myself as a teacher, and so I want to provide you with information so that you can use that information to go out and to share with others, and to use it to formulate your own opinions about things. So there were about three or four commenters in my one video who gave me this link, and someone had asked about the where does it actually say, is it a law that a sitting president can't be indicted? Well, it's not a law, but it is an opinion that was offered back in 2000, and so it is commonly accepted that that is the rule, okay? It's not an official rule. And this happened back on Monday, October 16th, 2000. And it was, you know, basically the indictment or criminal prosecution of a sitting president would unconstitutionally undermine the capacity of the executive branch to perform its constitutionally assigned functions. And then here's the PDF that you can read. I'm really not going to go through it and read it all, but I will read you the conclusion at the end. And so if you just go down here, because as a memorandum, you know, he laid down the entire case for why he came to this conclusion. So I'm going to share the conclusion with you, but I think you already know it. And this is done by Randolph D. Moss, who was at the time Assistant Attorney General, Office of Legal Counsel. And so this is what he had to say. In 1973, the Department of Justice concluded that the indictment and criminal prosecution of a sitting president would unduly interfere with the ability of the executive branch to perform its constitutionally assigned duties, and would thus violate the constitutional separation of powers. No court has addressed this question directly, but the judicial precedents that bear on the continuing validity of our constitutional analysis are consistent with both the analytic approach taken and the conclusions reached. Our view remains that a sitting president is constitutionally immune from indictment and criminal prosecution. So yes, it could technically go to court, and I guess there's a possibility that it would be ruled differently, but I don't think it will, because he lays out quite an interesting and very detailed explanation for why he takes that position. And it's 39 pages long, so again, I'm not going to read it all to you or anything like that, but I will give you the link down below in the description. Remember, if you can't see the description down below the video, it might be that you have to like click a little drop-down arrow or possibly some little dots or something that will allow that to drop open. And then you'll see the links to all of these pages I'm going to give you. And so you can go through and read it on your own. If you're really into legal stuff, then you probably find this fascinating. But, you know, not that I don't like some legalese, but boy, 39 pages. Yeah, I skimmed it, okay, and I didn't read from stem to stern, but I did kind of get the gist of it. And so he does have, you know, reasons and legal precedent that he is setting out there so that, you know, there are reasons behind this conclusion. And this is the conclusion that has been out there since 2000. So, long time, and it's pretty well established. Anyway, so I'll leave those links down below, but I really wanted to do this video because I found this website, and I think it does a really good job of taking the Mueller report and then showing you how there's some problems with it, you know, some inconsistencies. And this particular one deals mostly with the hacking, okay? And so if you are really into computers and hacking, you'll probably find this a very fascinating article. I know a lot about computers, and I've used computers for a very long time because I'm old, and I can do pretty well with most programs, but I really don't know that much about the hacking aspect of things, okay? So if you're really into hacking or you know a lot about that aspect of computers, you will understand this probably even better than I did. So it goes through, and pretty much it takes all the different things, and it gives you the little segments here that it's talking about from the Mueller report, and it gives you the page number that it's on. Now, I'm not sure if that's the actual page number. I forgot to look. or if that's the PDF page number, because remember there's a little bit of a difference there because of the front matter that used Roman numerals instead of regular page numbers. So if you go through here, he really is dealing with the part about the GRU, which was the Russian intelligence that was supposed to have hacked into, you know, the DNC. Well, you know, he points out some very good things in it. And he mentions this indictment here. This was an indictment of the Russians, all these Russians and everything. And, you know, this indictment seems kind of odd to me. Now, I could be wrong on this. And, you know, this is very possible. Because, again, I am not a lawyer, so I don't necessarily know some of the rules that go into how they form one of these. But this was the indictment. And when they go through, they make a lot of claims about the Russian Federation and the GRU and their units and that they did these things. You know, engaged in cyber operations that involved the staged releases of documents, stolen through computer intrusions, etc., etc. I mean, that's what they do all throughout this. But what struck me as I was reading it, and kind of what this guy points out, is that there seemed to be no connections. You know, they say these people did these things, but we're not seeing how they know those people were the ones who did it. You know, so I don't know if that's just because they can't get into, you know, the methods and things like that. But it just seemed to me very odd that they make a lot of claims that these people did these things, but I see no underlying evidence to support what they did. I also noticed that the dates are really weird. They use a lot of in or around this date. In or around. Well, you know, if they did some things, don't you think they would have more of an idea of the specific dates that it happened? And some of them have to do, you know, beginning in or around, in or around. It's used all the time. And then they get into the Guccifer 2.0, and even with that, in or around November 2016, do they not know for sure? And that makes me question it even more, because wouldn't they know more specific dates? It just seems like it. If they have the evidence that these people did these things, why does the indictment make it sound like they're not sure of any of these dates? So that was just my question when I started reading this indictment. But back to this, he goes through and he makes a lot of connections. And, you know, he has a lot of articles that he links to, like this one is to a C-SPAN video. And I mean, he does a really excellent job. Now, if I went through this entire thing, it would probably be a 2-hour long video. So, because he goes back and forth between, you know, the Mueller report and what he's saying, he definitely connects them and he points out the places where the problems lie. And so I thought it was a very interesting article to read, but I'm not sure it would be a very good one for me to pass on to you because of all the back and forth and everything. I think it's probably better if you look at it yourself. And here he's talked about in the indictment, these middle servers were overseas, and yet some of the hacking occurred here in the United States. And if they have the middle servers that are overseas, why would they bother to have something from here in the United States? And, you know, it just goes back and forth and back and forth. And it almost seems like they wanted to get caught. He points out some very good logical things. And so, again, it's really a long article, but it was really interesting to read. And there's some issues about this May 25th to June 1st time frame, because some of the metadata in these emails indicated May 23rd, 2016 is when they were acquired, which is very contradictory. So there are some contradictions that go on, and he points them out. Why did they not record that? Why did CrowdStrike not refer that to the FBI? And, you know, it just was quite an interesting article again. And there are a few things that I wanted to point out specifically, but some of it has to do with timing with WikiLeaks. And this was a chart that showed that it didn't have any general election results because of the publication of the documents. And so I thought that was kind of interesting. And let me find it. Like I said, it's really a long article. So down here, yep, almost there. I don't want to scroll too fast for you. But yeah, here the modification date, not the creation date, was recorded as 19 September 2016. And that's what they were using, that date, the 19th of September. But that was not the creation date. The creation date was actually back up here, Saturday, May 4th. You know, so there's some timing issues, some real timing issues that they have to deal with. And then, of course, there's this about Seth Rich, and he mentions the whole issue about that because the Mueller report says it was not Seth Rich. This is what it says. The statements about Seth Rich implied falsely that he had been the source of the stolen DNC emails is itself a false statement. The reason Assange gave for offering a reward for information leading to the conviction of Seth Rich's killers was our sources take risks and they become concerned when they see things occurring like that, the death of DNC worker Seth Rich. We have to understand how high the stakes are in the United States. And that was something that was a quote from this video right here. And I will link to that too, because Julian Assange basically in this video says Seth Rich was the one. He doesn't say it exactly. He doesn't come out and say it exactly. But he does imply it very heavily. And I don't know how you could listen to this and not make the connection. It just is very obvious there. So anyway, back to this. There's just so much in here, again, that I'm not going to go through because it really is a long article. But some of it is because of all of those. And they talk, here is they talk about the omission of the May 23rd because some of them had that data. And there were timing issues, whereas May 23rd came out that their creation date was after WikiLeaks published them. It was weird. So, you know, there's an assumption that somebody messed with stuff, you know? It was not just as easy as it was. And I did like what he had to say. He was talking about if you were in a crime scene and you were an employee at that crime scene, and if you said to the cops, oh, no, that's okay. You can take my word for it. I examined the evidence for you. And that's essentially what happened because CrowdStrike was an employee of the DNC. They examined the crime scene, which was the DNC server, and the FBI never examined it. And you know what? The FBI doesn't have to have your permission. If something's part of a federal crime, they go in and do it. But oh no, they didn't do it for that. Anyway, if you're into this kind of stuff and you want to know more about the whole Guccifer 2.0 and some of the reasons why, you know, he put this together and he says there are inconsistencies, each of these is a different article and they come from different sources. So very interesting. They go into a lot of detail and they pick it apart. And there are some reasons why the Mueller report, when it comes to all of this, was not accurate. So anyway, you know, reliability of attribution method. This one says, there's no basis whatsoever to attribute the use of known intrusion elements to Russia, not even if they were once reverse routed to Russia, which claim has never been made by NSA or any other of our IC. And so he has that person who gave him that statement. And then the chain of custody I thought was interesting. Without an anchor, there's no chain. And this is where he talks about the crime scene. And, you know, you have a chain of custody in a crime scene and it has to be kept very clean. So there's no possibility for that evidence to be tainted. And so there was no chain of evidence. I mean, the procedure was not followed. It's very clear that it was definitely done differently. And so I thought that was an interesting little article in there too. And you know, conflict of interest inherent in the investigation. And then the conclusion basically is the special counsel seems to have been impervious to critical pieces of countervailing evidence, some of which demonstrate that Guccifer 2.0 deliberately manufactured Russian breadcrumbs, and they have failed to accurately account for the acquisition of WikiLeaks DNC emails, missing the date on which approximately 70 of them were collected, which is, in itself, a stunning failure for a supposedly thorough investigation costing U.S. taxpayers tens of millions of dollars. There should have been a proper, thorough, independent, and impartial investigation into the Guccifer 2.0 persona. The special counsel certainly hasn't done that job, and, in retrospect, looks to have been ill-equipped and perhaps somewhat reluctant to do so from the outset. So some of you may have an expertise in this area. It'd be interesting to hear your comments down below and, you know, about it. Read it and see what you think. Is his argument logical? It seemed logical to me, but again, there I have some gaps in that area. And then with this indictment, if you're into legal stuff, I would be interested in hearing your thoughts about this too, because again, is this standard procedure that you don't tell how these people were connected? Because, like I said, I don't see the connection in this. All I see is they did this, they did this, they did this. But I don't see this is how we know they did this. Okay? So that's what I've got for you tonight on this one. And again, I'll leave the link to this one down below if you haven't seen it already, because it pretty much settles the case, in my opinion, that the source was not Russian hacking. Okay? So anyway, that's what I've got for you on this one. I want to thank you for stopping by, and I'll see y'all later.